Thanks very much for tuning in to Bloomberg Quint. I have with me Puneet Dalmia of the Dalmia Bharat Group. Thank you very much, Puneet. What a beautiful day here in Davos.
Yes, it really
is. You're brave. You're walking around without an overcoat. We'll try not to freeze you. Let me start by asking what you expect 2018 will be for the Indian economy, because your business is so closely linked to how the economy does.
I think a lot of big things are going to happen. First, I think the NCLT process has started, and a lot of these idle assets sitting on banks' balance sheets are going to get cleaned out in steel, power, some in cement. So I think by end of this year, a lot of these idle assets are going to get new owners, and they will also become performing assets in the balance sheets of banks. So the credit cycle should hopefully start post September, at least in the corporate side.
Okay.
I think secondly, there has been big announcements on infrastructure development, and I think the government is very clear that to create sustainable economic growth over 20-30 years, there is consensus that India needs more in infrastructure. So while there has been enormous progress in accelerating infrastructure development, like roads, we built 48,000 kilometers of rural roads last year. There has been huge progress on electrification and huge progress on creating digital infrastructure like Aadhaar. Literally 1.2 billion people are connected at a cost of $1.4 billion. That's just $1, slightly higher than a dollar per person. It's the largest digital rollout in the history of mankind. So I think physical infrastructure as well as digital infrastructure. Already there has been a lot of momentum, but I think that will get further accelerated in the coming years. And I think that will create a great foundation for the economy to deliver superb growth over the next 10-20 years.
I've learnt in Davos not to try and predict beyond the year that you're looking at. So I'll ask you the question on what you expect volume growth will be like for 2018. You've been doing about 6% in the last few quarters.
I think our volume growth in cement has been double digits. We have been in the mid-teens.
Okay.
And I think overall for the industry, it has been around 6%. You're right.
Yeah.
But my view is that, there are infrastructure is a good driver. Affordable housing is a good driver. But real estate is a big dampener because of demonetization, RERA, and GST.
Yeah.
So I think we are seeing a massive shrinkage in organized real estate. So on balance, we think... if the industry can do around 6-7% at an all-India level, that will be very healthy.
Which means you're effectively saying that you will maintain the kind of volume growth you've seen in the first two quarters of this fiscal?
Maybe a few points higher, 7-8%.
Okay.
Yeah.
What about pricing?
I think, there is a cost push right now in terms of energy prices going up.
Yeah.
So oil prices are going up, and that means coal prices as well as pet coke prices are going up.
Particularly with the pet coke issue, right?
Yeah. But, and also diesel prices are going up. So I think there is a cost push. Some of it can be passed on depending upon demand supply scenario in various markets. It's not one uniform market, as
of
you know.
Not, yeah.
So my view is that it will be a mixed bag depending upon demand and depending upon the market structure and the conditions in every pocket.
Where do you expect stronger pricing?
We are seeing very strong pricing in north right now.
Hmm.
And we are seeing healthy pricing in deep south, although it has been a little weak in the last few months. In Bihar and also in some pockets of Maharashtra, it was quite weak.
Hmm.
There were sand issues because sand prices have gone up literally 5x because of the crackdown on the sand mafia. So I think some of these things, you have to pay a short-term price for cleaning up the system. But I think in longer term, it's much better. And I think we don't make any investment with a one-year time horizon.
Of course not.
We make investments with a long-term time horizon. So a few short-term blips here or there along the way in some markets are not something that bother us.
But the last two quarters of this current fiscal and the first two quarters of the next fiscal, which is FY18-19, you expect cost pressures to have a substantial impact on your bottom line?
I think it already is happening. If you look at the last quarter results of Ultratech, there has been some margin compression owing to higher fuel costs. And let's see, many of the results are going to come out in the next couple of weeks. So we'll get a larger industry trend on what's happening. So yes, in the short term, I think there are cost pressures. And also Ultratech consolidated one of the largest acquisitions in the history of the industry, which was running at a low capacity utilization. So I think as they ramp that up, there will be a little bit of supply pressure also in some markets. So yes, I think a couple of quarters might be a little volatile in terms of margins. But longer term, I think as demand picks up and as more consolidation happens due to this NCLT, industry should have a reasonably healthy margin going forward.
So you're effectively, can you give us a sense of what band your margins will exist in, let's say, over the next few quarters, given all of these cost pressures, given the fact that, you know, demand isn't picking up the way you'd like to see it, at least in the short to medium term, and, you know, pricing is therefore weak?
Yeah, so if you look at the, margins of the top players, it's somewhere around 1,000 rupees per ton EBITDA. The slightly more efficient ones are somewhere around 1100, 1200 rupees a ton. And the less efficient ones are maybe 600, 700 rupees a ton. So I think that's the spread, but largely, let's say it's a 1000 rupee ton number. If you look at the recent quarter, I think Ultratech is about 800, 850. So it is like 15% below the normal number. But I think if you look at the investment, which is happening in this industry and the fair return requirement in this industry, even if you want to make like, 12, 13% return, and most people would like maybe like mid-teens kind of return, the EBITDA per ton has to go up to 1500 to 1700. And I saw a Goldman Sachs report which said that assuming a 75% capacity utilization, for a return in the like mid-teens, the EBITDA has to be 2,000 rupees a ton. So I think overall, at these prices and these margins, new investments are absolutely unviable. So I think over a long term, I expect slowly margins to rise as the industry consolidates and demand picking up, provided there are no irrational investments in the sector.
Great, but you still didn't tell me what you expect your margins to come in the next two quarters.
So I think it's difficult for us to predict because, also we don't like to give forward guidance.
A band of what kind of?
I think we are doing 1100 to 1200 rupees a ton already, which
and
is above
will you,
the.
Will it be
industry
a stretch to maintain that? Let me put it this way: so you have a more qualitative answer to give rather than a quantitative.
I think in the short term, yes, because there are cost pressures.
Okay.
But I think we have a very strong strategy on developing strong brands and. Moving our shift to more specialized products and more retail business. So hopefully we'll be able to offset a part of these cost pressures through branding and a more B2C business.
Okay, but you're still not going to actually increase price if it comes at the cost of market share. So I assume that, you know, margins will be the first to give in the next few quarters till you see a recovery in demand, which is really where you'll be able to, sort of regain pricing
Absolutely.
Pressure. Okay, so the story goes that, you're the second highest bidder for Binani and not the first, and that JSW Steel is the top bidder. Is that true, firstly, that? Are you willing to lose the asset because that gives you some great strategic geographical presence? Is there any other asset you've got in sight? How much have you put away or put aside, or how much have you allocated towards inorganic growth this year?
So look, we were the first, to participate in this NCLT resolution process. And I'm quite proud and happy that one asset, which is called Murli Industries, that's got resolved. It's the first non-promoter NCLT resolution which has happened.
Yes.
And, we are quite happy to be
it's
a part
small.
Of the solution.
Very small.
Yes, it's 3 million tons.
Yeah.
So it's not as large as Binani, but it is still a reasonable sized asset. And I think we are looking at distressed assets in a very serious way, because in the last 4 to 5 years, we have developed a very strong capability to acquire and integrate assets and turn them around. And I think some of these assets require capital infusion as well as good management.
Sure.
They are good assets located in good markets, but if you just change the capital structure, provide them working capital and give good management, I think there are returns to be made here. So clearly that's an area which is of strategic focus. However, having said that, we feel that in this business, you have to be strategic and you have to be willing to pay up I think you have to maintain capital allocation discipline. So
every business, Puneet. Yeah.
Every business. So I think we don't want to be very aggressive in terms of how we bid.
Are you the top bidder or the second bidder?
Look, we don't know. I think, but all we know is...
You won't know, the bids have opened.
No, so. We read in the newspapers that JSW is the largest bidder, but formally we don't know.
Okay.
However, we know that all the bidders, whether they were higher or lesser in terms of bid, have been called for the next round of discussion.
Okay. So you have an opportunity to better your price.
Yes, all the six bidders have.
Okay. So, are you going to fight hard for this one? Because it gives you strategic geographical presence.
So clearly this is a strategic acquisition for us, but I think we are also very returns focused. So we are going to remain balanced in terms of how we bid. And we have done a fair amount of work on this. So we know what are the opportunities and what are the challenges in this asset. It's a market where we have low-cost competitors, with very under-leveraged balance sheets. So it's not going to be easy in this market to, revive this asset and aggressively ramp up the asset. So it's going to be an asset which will give you returns over the longer term. But North is an attractive market. So having, to balance the initial, pain of ramping up the asset and getting margins back versus, balancing the strategic advantage of entering a good market is something we need to balance. But we are very clear. We don't want to take our debt to EBITDA above a certain level.
Which is?
And currently, I think we will end March 18 at around 2-1.
Okay.
We don't want to go beyond 3 to 3.5.
Okay. In fact, one of the questions I was going to ask you is, what are you going to do to reduce debt? But it clearly seems at this point in time, if you're in acquisition mode to be able to acquire some of these assets, then you're going to go the reverse way, right?
I think we're in a pretty good position right now. So debt to EBITDA of 2-1 already is a pretty healthy number. Hmm. And I think we already have some firepower on the balance sheet to, expand. So personally, I think if the debt to EBITDA is within 3 to 3.5, it's a healthy number. If we are too under leveraged, that's also not a good capital structure.
Yeah.
And if you're too aggressive, then you create high risk for your investors.
Okay. If you lose Binani, what is the plan for the North then?
I think right now we are taking it one step at a time.
There's no other asset I know of that's in the NCLT process, I mean, of that strategic size and nature, etc., especially in that geography.
That's a very good question. We already have some mines in North, so even if, depending upon how this plays out, competitive processes are always uncertain. But we have greenfield opportunities in North, so it's not as if that we cannot enter this market.
But you just spent some time in the interview telling me this is not possibly the right time to put in new capacity, because neither is the demand situation favorable nor is the fragmented nature of this industry favorable at this point in time. So I'm assuming you might not want to go the greenfield route, and that you will continue to look for acquisition opportunities. Are there any others besides Binani and NCLT?
No, look, again, demand supply varies from market to market. And if you look at the capacity utilization in North, it's the best right now.
Right.
So North is an area where people will put new capacity. Already Ultratech has announced, Wonder Cement has announced, Holcim has announced some new capacity. And also bear in mind that whenever we do greenfield investments, it is not overnight.
So no, it'll take three to five years
to put up.
So
by that time,
you expect demand supply
should improve.
Okay. So if you don't get Binani, you're hoping to go the greenfield route. Is that a fair understanding
Look,
of this?
We have a portfolio of expansion opportunities in the group across regions. And I think we'll have to prioritize them depending upon how we feel each market or each region is behaving. So at this point in time, I cannot say what is going to be our priority, because we are still evaluating all projects and rating them in terms of attractiveness. There are some brownfield projects, there are some greenfield projects, there are some acquisition opportunities. So I think it's very important for us to balance short-term returns with long-term positions.
Okay.
And at this point in time, I think all I can say is, we are lucky to have choices across the board, and we will make those choices wisely and hopefully create value over the medium term.
Is there anything else besides Binani in the NCLT process right now that looks attractive to you?
I think Binani is the largest asset right now.
I can't think of any other cement asset that's in the process, is it?
Kalyanpur hai, ek chota.
Ah, okay.
1 million.
Yeah, sorry. Very, very tiny. Right, yeah. Okay, great. So we're going to leave it there with one last question, and that is, what is the most interesting thing you've done in Davos in the last 4 days that you've been here?
I think I've been learning to walk on snow and with these clips on.
Yeah, so, well, that's the smartest thing, because otherwise you'll go for a toss, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
So. And I think I've been, I've met some very interesting people, and it's been a very stimulating, session, many sessions. I did a session on the life of a refugee. It was a simulation. It was a very intense experience, and we did it only for 40 minutes, and it was quite stressful. And then we were told that the stress levels is 14% of what an actual refugee feels.
Goes through. Mm.
And this was just for 40 minutes. And the average life of a refugee in a refugee camp is 25 years.
Yeah.
So it was a very moving experience. And it just tells us that how much people in Davos who are very privileged need to think more about giving back to society and being engaged with their mind and their hearts in something which is beyond them and have a larger purpose in life.
In saying that, you've touched upon the big globalization debate that's sort of taken center stage here over the last 2-3 days. Thank you, Puneet, for speaking with us.
Thank you, Menaka.
All the best for your plans for 2018. And do let us know when you put in the revised bid for Binani Cement. With that, we're going to wrap it up here with Puneet Dalmia. Thanks very much for watching.